So continuing with the classification of one-dimensional manifolds, let me restate our earlier theorem that we wanted to prove. Okay, so let X be a connected one-dimensional Hausdorff and second countable, that is under assumption, okay, an abstract topological manifold. Then X is homeomorphic to one of the following, the open interval 0, 1, half closed interval 0, 1, closed interval 0, 1, or the circle S1. Recall that we also reduce the K, reduce this proving this theorem to the case of proving when a boundary of X is empty. Okay, then we have to prove that is either it is open interval 0, 1 or the circle. This is what we want to prove. Okay, so we had already reduced that case to that one. Okay, so where do we start off? We start off with the definition. And of course, later on we'll say, look, this is connected and it's Hausdorff, this is second countable, etc. We keep on using those. Okay, so the definition gives you immediately the following lemma, namely, take more generally, take any n manifold, not necessarily one dimensional manifold, then X is the quotient of a countable disjoint union of copies of open disk Dn. Okay, it is a quotient space of some disjoint union of open disks. All manifolds are like that. By second countability argument, there is a countable atlas. Every manifold has a atlas. Here we have a countable atlas. So let us call it Ui phi I, okay? I belonging to N. This I belonging to N for X, where phi I from Ui to Dn are homeomorphisms. Okay, now you take M to be disjoint union of Dn's as many as, you know, countably many, whatever. It is finite, then finitely many of this family, okay, disjoint union of Dni. What is Dni? Each Dni is a copy of Dn, open unit disk. But disjoint union abstractly. Okay, from there I can define a quotient map now, namely Q from M to X be the map given by on each copy Dni, take it as the inverse image of phi I. Remember, what are phi I's? Phi I's are from maps from Ui to Dn. So phi I inverse will be from Dn to X going into Ui, okay? So they are all maps into X, but they go into Ui. So Q restricted Dni is phi I inverse. Since Dni's are disjoint copies, so this definition makes it completely defined on Q, and it will be continuous. Because this is an atlas, that means union of Ui's in the whole of X, this Q will be surjective. So it is a quotient, as a set theoretically, it is a quotient map. But it is also an open mapping. On each of these open subsets, Dni's, it is a homeomorphism. Therefore, it is an open mapping. Any surjective open mapping is a quotient map. So it is more than that. So it is stronger than it is a open mapping. Okay, so the theorem is over, this lemma is over. We have displayed it as a countable union of this one. Of course, when I say I, at the most I, it could be finite also here. So that is also allowed. Okay. So next, we would like to make some bargaining here. We don't want all those, you know, some of them may be useless and so on. What are the meaning of useless? So this is what we want to do. By deleting those open sets which are already covered by the union of previous members. See, we have already listed. We have already made a listing. U1, U2, U3 and so on. If U2 is already covered by U1, what is the point? You just delete it. U2, there is no need for U2. Go to U3. Go to U4. Suppose U1, U2, U3, U4 cover U5. Then what is the use of U5? Delete that one and so on. So delete those members which are already covered by all the previous members. Union of the previous members. This is what I want to do. Okay. So in the listing UIFI, starting with N0 equal to W0 equal to UN0. U1. That is U1. This is our notation. U1 is UN0. Okay. And that I call it a W0. Let N1 be the least number of for which UN1 is not contained inside W0. Keep going. Maybe U2 is not contained in. Then U2 will be called as UN2. So this is a subsequence I am going to. A 2 will be N2. If 2 is already there, U2 is already there, then I will go to U3. Like this. The first one, the smallest one, which is contained, not contained in. So that will be N1. UN1. Okay, so call just N1 be that one. So you call W2 equal to UN0 U reunion. So that is second one, W2. So like this, you put WK plus 1, define it as WK union UN plus 1K. What is the property of UN plus 1K? It is not contained inside WK. WK is the union of the previous members. Okay. So I think this is very clear. Of course, if the list is finite, you will stop at some place. Otherwise, it can go on. You don't know. Even if the original list is infinite, you may end up with a finite list. Like if it's a compact space, somebody might have given you an infinite covering. But because it's a compact space, you can always get away with a finite covering. Okay. So, take the modified covering with the property that the nth open set coming is not contained in the union of the first n minus 1 of them. That is the property I want. That's all. Okay. Some simplification. In what follows, we shall assume that UIFI is a countable and minimal atlas in the previous sense. Okay. So all the extraneous UIs have been deleted, that's it. Now take phi I equal to, psi I equal to phi I inverse from minus 1 plus 1 to x. Now it's a special case, namely n equal to 1 now. Okay, we are into the n equal to 1 case now. Okay, phi I inverse of minus 1 plus 1 d1, minus d1 is minus 1 plus 1, okay, to x. So you may think of x as a quotient of a disjoint union of countably many copies of minus 1 plus 1. That is the lemma. Okay. And Q is the quotient map d1i to x, where Q restricted to t1i is psi I, the inverse of these coordinate charts. So they are called actually parameterization psi. Therefore, to understand x, what our manifold is, we need to unravel what kind of identifications are taking place under this quotient map. Any quotient map is same thing as introducing equivalence relation. Okay, so what are these equivalence classes there? Which points are identified with where? That is what we have to understand. All right, therefore we start. So this is the picture that I have. This is some one-dimensional manifold, possibly. These are all intervals of minus 1 to plus 1. And there are these parameterizations. This part will cover something, that part will cover something, and so on. Okay? So it's quotient of disjoint union of minus 1 plus 1. Now put U1, 2, U2, 1, U3, 1, U4, 1, or U2i, and so on. So Uij, more generally, equal to psi I inverse of psi j of dn1. Take an interval, go to its image through one of the j's, whatever, psi j, and then take psi I inverse of that. So psi I inverse of that may not be the whole interval, because that may be covering something else, right? So, but it will be a subset of, when you take psi I inverse, it will be a subset of ui. What is ui? D1i, right? So it's a subset of d1i. You can call that d1i as ui also, more generally. Okay, it is coming from uj, so therefore I'm saying uij. This is notation. Psi I inverse of psi j of d1j. Okay, so each of them is an open subset of d1i, the first one. It is a subset of d1i. To begin with, we need to know what are the possibilities for each component uij, components of uij, inside this ui is minus 1 plus 1. Ui or d1i is minus 1 plus 1. Okay, I would prefer to write it as ui, and remember that they are all minus 1 plus 1. Remember u and j, as uij is some open subset of this minus 1 plus 1. Okay, what are these components, and how the maps are related, what kind of maps do we get? This is what we have to understand. Okay, that it's possible to understand these things is surprising. Because it's one dimension, it is possible. Okay, so let me illustrate this with an example. Okay, this example will tell you most of the story, actually, what is happening. Suppose the atlas consists of just two charts only. Concentrate on one ui and uj, and psi I there and psi j there. Just concentrate on that part, what is happening to begin with. Okay. So we can assume that M itself is D11 union D12 instead of I and J and so on. Then let us consider some simple cases here, namely the following cases. The first case A is U12 is open interval 1/2 to 1. Contained inside U1. U21 is open interval minus 1 to minus 1 by 2. Okay? That's a possibility. Because U12 is subset of U1 and U21 is subset of U2, the other one. So here I have 1/2 to 1, there it is minus 1 to minus 1 by 2. Okay? Now, if I go from here, psi I and then psi 2 inverse, psi 1 and psi 2 inverse, I will get from here to here, from this interval to that interval, a homeomorphism. Composite of two homeomorphisms, homeomorphism. So what could be, let us say that it is something like t going to t plus 3 by 2. I have to be careful. If I add 3 by 2, half will go to, so from here, minus 1 will go to half, and minus 1/2 will go to 1. Okay, so from psi 2 to psi 1 inverse psi 1. So from U21 to U12, this is the homeomorphism, T1, T plus. I am just assuming, I am not proving anything. One of the homeomorphisms, so take the easiest one. Or it may be the other way around, namely, what is this one? Just minus t. This one going to minus t. Even simpler. Okay? So what happens under these two cases? Let us understand. Okay, in the first case, we can take alpha from M. M is what? M is disjoint union of these two, this is notation, D1 and D2, like this. Okay. So from M, I will define minus 1 to 5 by 2 by restricting on the first copy of minus 1 plus 1, it is just T. On the second copy, I will just shift it by 3 by 2, like this one, and take T plus 3 by 2. Okay, so that this alpha will agree with these identifications. Okay, so that is the whole, this, if T goes to T, T goes 3 by 2 and then goes to T. So that is why you take alpha T here, and on the cis part, you take T plus 3 by 2. It's easily checked that this map, which is defined on the disjoint union, factors down to X. X is a quotient space, remember. Okay? To alpha hat from minus 1 to 5 by 2. You can see that this is a surjective and it's a 1-1 mapping. Okay? It is open, it's actually homeomorphism on each part can be verified. So this will be homeomorphism. Okay? So here is the picture for that. So this is 1 by 2 to 1. This is your U12 here. And this is U21. And this is your X now. I don't know what X is, but I have actually got it this way. Okay, the quotient space has to be, this gets identified with this one by shifting the T going to 3 by 2. This goes to T here, but this goes to 3 by 2 times this one. So they agree. A point here is identified, the point here, but both span side will agree on that part. So therefore, these two patch up together to give you a map from X to this whole interval from minus 1 to what, 7 by 2 or whatever, 5 by 2. So in this case, what we have proved is the manifold X is again an interval, open interval. Its length may be larger, don't worry. We are not interested much in the length. Okay? Let us see what happens in the second case, which is, this looks like simpler. Namely, T going to minus T. T going to minus T, you are just reversing the direction. So in the picture, I can just write this way. So this is minus 1 to plus 1. This is minus 1 to plus 1 the other way around. Okay, here. Right? This is minus 1 to plus 1 the other way around. All right. Now, a point here, see, 1 by 2 to this one, goes to, actually 1 by 2 and 1 by 2, 1 by 2 and minus 1 by 2 go to the same thing. 1 by 2 goes to minus 1 by 2 and that's going here. So this one goes to minus 1, T go to minus T and that goes to here. That's why I have written like this. Okay. Drawing picture is this way, is here. Okay. So what happens is, this portion, they are identified. But this portion and this portion are different. So you have to draw pictures like this. What happens to the minus 1 by 2 and 1 by 2? They are not identified. Only the open interval are identified. This point, this black point here, it is not a part of the manifold, because I have taken open intervals. Remember that. So on this side, I have not shown them at all. But here I have shown it because it is involved. But here I have put a red mark here. What happens? These points are not identified. The open interval is identified. What happens to those two points? They will be in the closure of both of them will be closure in this open interval part here. Therefore, Hausdorffness of X is violated here. conclusion is that we don't want to accept that Hausdorff is not violated, but we want to say that our own assumption is wrong. Namely, we cannot have the second case at all. Psi 1 inverse of psi 2 will not be minus t. So this is acceptable. It gives you a long line, longer interval. So the identifications, if you have an interval like this, an interval like this, identification like this is allowed. Identification like this, this is not allowed. That is the meaning of it. If you do like that, there will be a point here and a point here which will come close enough but remain distinct. That means what? An open part, open interval has both of them as in the closure. Okay, so there will be no interval around them which are disjoint, which means that Hausdorff is violated. Okay, so that is the gist of this one example. I will tell you one more example, which is much more interesting one. Okay. So this is done. So B. So here I am assuming U12 is -1/2, -1/3, and 1/3 to 1. So U12 consists of two connected components. In the case A, it was connected. Here it is not connected, but it has two components. Okay, U12. And U21 is also -1/2, 1/3, and 1/3 to 1. This is just an assumption. This is a simpler case, okay? Here, suppose psi 1 inverse of psi 2 is, again, I have to make a case, t plus 4 by 3 on the first component, namely -1/2, -1, t < 1/3, -1/3. It is t plus 4, 3. And on the other part, it is t -4/3. What does it mean? See, you have two things here. One interval. I didn't make a picture of this one because this was much easier actually. So I let you make a picture for yourself. So if using this picture itself, for example, what is happening is there are another interval here. This interval is shifted to this interval, another interval here, and this interval is shifted to this interval. Okay, it is just a shifting homeomorphism. Okay, so that is the case I am looking at. Okay, in which case you define beta from the disjoint union of these two copies of -1 + 1 by these formulas, namely take t going to e power pi I 3t by 4. See, -1 to +1, if you take pi I t, it will cover the entire circle exactly once. Right? But here, I am covering it only 3/4 of it. So 3t by 4. Okay? The first one covers that much of. Some other part is left out. Beta is, the second part is covering it. D2 is covering it. Namely, 3t plus 4 by 4, which means rotated by pi, rotated by through an angle pi, whatever you have taken. So those two will cover the whole thing. Okay. So this beta is defined from M to S1. Okay. There are these two are disjoint copies. You can define whichever you like. So the beta is a surjective mapping. All right. What are the points which go to the same point? They will be precisely given by this. So these are the relations here. Therefore, what happens is that beta factors down from M through the quotient map Q from X to S1. And that map beta hat from X to S1 will be a homeomorphism. Okay, so what you have done is taking two arcs like this and then forming this kind of operation, identification. Portion here overlapping, portion here overlapping, that will give you a circle. So that is what is happening here. Okay. So I think these two examples explain the whole thing, whatever I wanted to tell you. The key here is, though these are look like very special examples, they will take care of most of the cases. So I have to make a general statement here, okay? There's a general fact indicated by these examples. We formalize this in the following two lemmas. The proof will be completely obvious. However, I implore you to write down it on your own. So take it as an assignment. Okay? So this is a statement. Let A less than B less than C, D less than E less than F be real numbers. Now, I am not even using that they are minus 1 plus 1 and all that. Okay? So this is the whole idea. Because for any open interval is homeomorphic to any other open interval. So that is why I am writing arbitrary. A less than B less than C, D less than E, B real number, M be the disjoint union of the two intervals A to C and D to F. Okay. Let alpha from BC to DE. See, BC is one end of the first interval and DE is other end, lower first interval, you know, this part, initial part of the second interval. Okay, DE. So alpha from BC to DE be an order preserving homeomorphism, like a shifting, adding. In the other case, which we violated, what was it? It was order reversing, T going to minus T. That was not a good one. So you have to take order preserving homeomorphism. Then the identification space, namely M is the disjoint union. You identify T with alpha T, where T is inside BC, open interval BC. This you call it as M alpha. Why alpha? Because this alpha is the identification map. So it's just M alpha. This will be homeomorphic to the open interval 0, 1. Okay. Now I can't write it is 3 by 4, 4 to 1 by 4, 1 to 1, 5 and so on. Okay. I don't care it either. Therefore, I am writing it as some open interval. Namely, it is homeomorphic to normally 0, 1. So this is the lemma. Okay. Similarly, you can have the second one, which will give you a circle. Okay, it's exactly similarly. So this is the first case. This is A1. A2 was a case which is not occurring. So B, case B is this covered by this one. Okay, in the example. Given, now I am taking minus 1 plus 1 itself to be more accurate. Given minus 1 less than A less than B less than 1, minus 1 less than C less than D less than 1. Let alpha from this end B to 1, you see, B1 to this end minus 1 plus 1. Okay. The end of the first one with the initial part of the second one. Or the other one, beta is minus 1 to A to D1. So this end and that end. Both of them be order preserving homeomorphisms again. Let X be the quotient of the disjoint union of the two copies of minus 1 plus 1. By the identification, T is identified with alpha T on this part, where T is between B and 1. And here it is using beta, T is identified as beta T on the second part, minus 1 to A. Then what you get is S1, homeomorphic to S1. The quotient space is homeomorphic to S1. Okay. Proof is you have to correctly copy this one without using these 4 by 3, etc. That is the challenge. Okay. Try it. So we are going to use this one. So further things we will take next time. So let these two examples sink properly in you. So next time we will discuss further proof of the classification. Thank you.